Ông quý chủ. Ông chủ nhiệm ra và cả tổ các chấm la ca nội tệ vị trí sản nạc ca lưu ông sẽ cái đây bình đất phó tàng lưu dân ông rừng xôn xôn bì xôn xôn bì tam cao bị phía sản nạc ca đại ban cầm nọt nâng kiểm điệp chôn phía kỳ nâng xa thiên ạ chôn cần lòng mốc hơi nơi thay ní ông nhầm ra chạp đàm thư sản nạc ca sản nạp tật khay cầm đàm mà đăng rạp rạp bình đi xạ xây vẹp bọn nâng ông hết chọt bà căn ca rạch than tập viên tùm núp tập viên thơm mô đây nơi khai ni ông nhầm đe nâng thưa sạm nà ca sát đập sạc khai cam đào mà đằng rọp đập vì ni đại miền hà sơn niêm p t c c p p rồi một hay có bàn tay đại miền sầm nà thay mối rồi bảo thạ bệ nhà ông đại chiết đại bàn ông nhầm đe bàn tập tuôn cả pì ngày gì một hay buôn khai cả cái đại chín năm pì pon đập rắm đại bàn đặng bằng sông bằng hai cầm nọt hết sẽ đáp trong lời xã xây bịa sông tăng khuôn dễ đàm mà đang rộp đạp bình đi bị tên ông rương xôn xôn bún bịa bọn nâng ông hết cả than tùm lục tùm bèng thơm mò mọc đã được nông xôn ông rương xôn xôn bí xa lạc xôn bí đổi ní ông nhầm rẻ trừ sẽ đáp xa ra nạp tòa mọt rồi bọc bị kì mà chắc xâm ná xa bệ nhá nâng xa ra nạp tòa mọt bị bị kì bịa bọn đồ tây tiết chìm môn sân môn sẽ đáp rưu mình sẽ đáp được khay cắm đào mà đang gặp được vị ní pi thì si pi pi rồi một hay nơi ngày ní hay ông chấm rác có xong chấm riệp chun phòng đá tha nơi khả năng cách phía xa sẽ đáp được khay cắm nơi có năng sạm nà cá nơi ngày ní nâng ngày bật to ông chấm rác xong chấm riệp chun đọt phía kỳ nơi đường cái đây ní tha nơi khả năng cách chấm nà cá sạm nà cá nơi thay ní nâng ai thay bản to bản to đại tụm nông chở hốt đo pi sapa đá lục sợi chở cầm cột địa phận đại chi chở cầm on trại chiết ạ vật tầm miên đại mùa hạt quạt miên thủ rẻ chăm bạch to khluôn quạt vận ai cho rùm được nông cây chăm nà ca sắm nà ca thị ban bản to pi dương nhom ban bị cướp chở bò chở mui nâng bản đa chở cầm bình sứt này ông nhầm rẻ sáu tờ bốn dương sầm rạch tay tăng lục chở cầm mặc tin gặp kín đại chi chở cầm mầm rong phe kỳ on trại chiết để chấm nuốt cái lạnh lục sợi chạy cầm cột địa phận đại áp vật miến đó đó pin á lục sợi chạy cầm cột địa phận miền vật miến nâng ai miền là tập hiệp bằng pin ca nghĩa con ca chồ rùm nâng con ca chấm nà ca sam nà ca nâng ông chấm đẹp là tập bông vinh ban ca sam lạnh đi đại ai lơ tam bắt bình nhát này bị thiên chất thập bốn bốn này bị thiên tây con ông đó bảo ông chấm đẹp bị sam mạnh con ông tổ la ca Campuchia làm chi sắm nạc cá lúc trời sai có vật thí đang đi cam vì sản phẩm vật miền ở vật miền phía kia được bộc lộ đại ông nhầm đẹp có chưa nhà cho rùm được không cần chấm nạc cá sắm nạc cá thay đi
xong cột lộc vật thiên xâm nhập sắm nạc cá được ngày ní làm chi có sông co khơi thả cột phía kia tiếng ở nơi đường đây ní miền vật miền đại lai lộc nôn chi miền vật miền nơi bản tộc không khôn khang cao sa sắm nạc cá ní đại lộ sna sâm lẹ bằng sắt miền vật miền đại toal pi bản tốc sạm nà cả đi khất lẹ bằng sắt rập bằng lộ nôn chi ban phật cô đo làm chi nội hài hơi đạm đằng rập bạ về ní đại trơ mộc đo sự khai cam nơi ngày ní miền rồi hạt niêm pi tccp pi rồi mập hầy đạm bản đằng rụp ní miền vật miền được nông bản tốc rong chám ca có hai pi ong chôn nương rẻ sum ong côn lục thiền
côn lục thầy sai câu vật thí chỉ được bốn ông nhầm rẻ xâm lách lừa xâm lao xong bỏ chun chập chọt nôn chi chỉ một thân ông nhầm rẻ ban được tu lịch khất xong lẽ bằng sức châu rúm sạm nà ca đại to là không một tụ sạm nà ca ní được bỏ chun chập chọt nôn chi cho ngày gì mà phải bẩm bờ khai cả cái đài cho năm bị bọn đập rắm đại ban bàn chẹt thá đại quạt miền bay nhà sọc cổ phìp chư cơ ba chư chừng cái mình ai anh quỳ u bán mình ai trong ròng bàn u nâng đầm bay miền là tập phìp châu rúm sạm nà ca được ngày khẳng mốc ở miền thật tập phìp luôn xong lẽ bằng sức châu rúm nâng miền vật miền đại to là không một tụ sạm nà ca ในทั้งไงที่มาเผยผมเปิลใครกะกระดาษฉน้ำปีปอนต์ปรำมีตัววิการปีใครบักล้วนมันปรับอัมพีพอลปะปอลในการแหลบบองเซตนี้ท้ายการแหลบบองเซตนี้มันอาจบ่สลายท้าเจียการแหลบบองเซตบักล้วนขนมกาการที่ใครได้ยุติท้อหรือเซตขนมกาจมตัวจะนึงพอตั้งขนมกาดับบังหัน ឬដាក់ជូនតឡាការនេះគ្រប់ពេលវេលានៃសកម្មភាពឬរុករួនឡើយបានឃើញកំណត់ហេតុពិនិត្យសុខភាពជនជាប់ចោតនួនជារដ្ឋធ្វើឡើងដោយគ្រូពេទ្យប្រចាំការពិនិត្យព្យាបាលថែទាំសុខភាពជនជាប់ចោតនៅអបតកចុះថ្ងៃទី21ខែកក្កដាឆ្នាំ2015បានកត់សម្គាល់ថាស្ថានភាពសុខភាពរបស់លោកនួនជាមានអាការៈឈឺចង្កេះជាប្រចាំមិនអាចអង្គុយយូរបាន និងផ្ដល់អនុសាសន៍ថាសូមអង្គជំរះអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យលោកនួនជាចូលរួមតាមដានកិច្ចដំណើរការសកម្មការពីបន្ទប់ខាងក្រោមសាលសកម្មការនេះហើយផ្អែកលើមូលដ្ឋាននេះនឹងតាមបទបញ្ញត្តិនៃវិធាន61 5នៃវិធាន ជាប់ប្រព័ន្ធតទួសម្រាប់ជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាអាចចូលរួមនឹងតាមដានកិច្ចដំណើរការសកម្មការពីចម្ងាយពីបន្ទប់ឃុំខ្លួនមួយស្ថិតនៅក្រោមសាលសកម្មការនេះក្នុងរយៈពេលនៃកិច្ចដំណើរការសកម្មការសម្រាប់ថ្ងៃនេះហើយមុននឹងដំណើរការនីតិវិធីសកម្មការពីនិតផតាំងអង្គជំរះសូមបញ្ជាក់ឡើងវិញជម្រាបជូនដល់ភាគីនិងសាធារណជនថាកាលពីថ្ងៃទី26ខែកក្កដាឆ្នាំ2015
សូមពីកិច្ចការិយាល័យសហប្រញ្ញាក្នុងការដាក់បង្ហាញកំណត់ហេតុស្ដាប់ចម្លើយពាក្យសុំតាំងខ្លួនជាដើមរងរដ្ឋវិនីនិងឯកសារពាក់ព័ន្ធមួយចំនួនទៀតសរុបចំនួន 54 ពីសំណុំរឿង 004 ពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងអង្គហេតុទំនប់ទំពាំងថ្មមកក្នុងសំណុំរឿងបច្ចុប្បន្ន 002/25គឺឯកសារ E319/25.2 ដោយសារតែឯកសារទាំងនេះពាក់ព័ន្ធទៅនឹងអង្គហេតុដែលអង្គជំរះគ្រោងនឹងធ្វើសកម្មភាពនៅថ្ងៃនេះហើយនឹងអាចនឹងប៉ះពាល់ដល់កាលវិភាគសកម្មភាពដែលអង្គជំរះបានកំណត់រួចហើយនោះហើយដូច្នេះអង្គជំរះបានជូនដំណឹងដល់ភាគីកាលពីថ្ងៃទី24ខែកក្កដាឆ្នាំ2015នេះថាអង្គជំរះនឹងស្ដាប់សេចក្តីសន្និដ្ឋានរបស់ភាគីថាតើឯកសារទាំងនេះនឹងនាំឲ្យប៉ះពាល់ដល់លទ្ធភាពនៃ របស់អង្គជំរះត្រូវធ្វើសកម្មភាពឬអង្គហេតុពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងការរដ្ឋានទំនប់ទំពាំងថ្មនោះដែររយ៉ាងណានៅថ្ងៃពុធនៅថ្ងៃពុរោះទី29នឹងថ្ងៃទី30ខែកក្កដាឆ្នាំ2015នៅក្នុងសប្តាហ៍នេះអង្គជំរះបានកំណត់ការប្រឆេះរួចហើយក្នុងការស្ដាប់ទៅខីកម្មសាក់សីចំនួន2រូបដែលមិនទាន់ពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងអង្គហេតុការរដ្ឋានទំនប់ទំពាំងថ្ម ហើយដែលការស្ដាប់សក្តិកម្មសាក់សីទាំងនេះមានផលប៉ះពាល់តិចតួចចំពោះការដាក់បង្ហាញឯកសាររបស់សហប្រញ្ញានៅថ្ងៃពុធទី26កក្កដាឆ្នាំ2015អង្គជំរះនឹងស្ដាប់សក្តិកម្មសាក់សីដែលមានហត្ថនាម ពីបញ្ចប់ការស្ដាប់សក្តិកម្មសាក់សីដែលមានហត្ថនាម2TC/26/1 26ពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងអង្គហេតុការដ្ឋានទំនប់មួយមករាហើយជាដំបូងនេះអង្គជំរះសូមជម្រាបជូនដល់ជំរាបសួរទៅតំណាងសហប្រញ្ញាថាតើឯកសារណាថាតើពេលណាឯកសារទាំងនោះនឹងត្រូវដាក់បង្ហាញហើយថាតើការដាក់បង្ហាញឯកសារទាំងនេះនឹងនាំឲ្យប៉ះពាល់ដល់ការ ដើមសកម្មភាពរបស់អង្គជំរះនៅថ្ងៃនេះដែលរឿងយ៉ាងណាហើយនៅក្នុងបញ្ហានេះអង្គជំរះជំរាបថាមិទ្វីនាំមុខតំណាងដើមនិងរដ្ឋប្រវេនីនិងមិទ្វីការពារក្តីទាំងពីរក្រុមអង្គជំរះនឹងផ្ដល់ឱកាសឲ្យធ្វើសារណាផ្ទាល់មាត់តបទៅនឹងការលើកឡើងរបស់សហប្រញ្ញាហើយភាគីនីមួយៗមានរយៈពេល 10 នាទីដើម្បីលើកឡើងនិងឆ្លើយតបអំពីការដាក់បង្ហាញឯកសារថ្មីនេះរបស់សហប្រញ្ញា ហើយជាដំបូងនេះអង្គជំរះសូមផ្ដល់វេទិកាជូនទៅតំណាងថាប្រញ្ញាដើម្បីអាចធ្វើការបញ្ជាក់បង្ហាញដោយផ្ទាល់មាត់នៅបញ្ហាសំណើសុំរបស់ខ្លួនហើយនឹងផលប៉ះពាល់ផ្សេងៗទៀតដែលពាក់ព័ន្ធជាមួយនឹងបញ្ហាការដាក់ឯកសារនេះធៀបជាមួយនឹងការដំណើរការកំណត់កាលបរិច្ឆេទការរៀបចំសកម្មភាពរបស់តុលាការថ្ងៃនេះហើយនឹងថ្ងៃបន្តបន្ទាប់សម្រាប់អង្គហេតុការដ្ឋាន
Thank you. Good morning, Mr. President, Your Honors. Let me first answer the first issue that was raised in the email you circulated on Friday, which is to address the substance and timing of the disclosure. There are essentially two types of documents that were disclosed in this filing. The first was five recent OCIJ interviews from Case 4. That contain some information relevant to trapping Thma Dam. As this court is aware, there have been a large number of witness interviews conducted in Case 4 relating to Prenet Prey District and therefore touching upon the trapping Thma Dam. Over 60 such interviews were disclosed earlier this year in March and April. Since that time, there have been five new OCIJ interviews relevant to the subject that were notified to us and which we received translations between May and July 2015. So that is the first group of documents disclosed, five new OCIJ interviews. The larger part of the disclosure consists of civil party applications, a total of 47 civil party applications, from Case 4 that relate or contain some references to the trapping Thma Dam. And there are two things I would like to note about those civil party applications. First, in regards to the number of pages disclosed, if you were to add up the total number of pages of the civil party applications, it would look fairly high, over 500 pages. But as this court knows, most of the pages in the civil applications are form matters with procedural content. Where the civil parties check boxes, biographical information, addresses, such things, copies of national ID cards. For each of these civil party applications, there are usually a one or two page insert at the end in which the civil party describes the information they have in terms of what they experienced during the regime. So we've gone through them, and the actual number of pages from these 47 civil party applications in which there are actual statements from the civil party is only 94 pages. For the five new OCIJ interviews, fortunately they are fairly short, so they total about 44 pages between the five. I would also note that only part of these filings actually relate to trapping Thma. When you look at these civil party applications, you usually see that there's perhaps one paragraph out of the one or two page description that is about trapping Thma. So there is perhaps my first comment is that there's not as much material to review as may appear if you look at the year-end pages. I was away in Canada the past 3 weeks, so the first time I saw these new materials was on Friday, and even in my jet lag condition, I was able to get through those materials in the afternoon. The second point I want to make sure that is understood about the civil party applications is that the date which appears in the annex we filed is the date that the document was prepared or signed by the civil party. It is not the date that the document was notified to our office or put on the case file. Civil party applications, as you may know, go through a process where they go through the victims unit who enters them into a database and does some other things that I'm not completely familiar with before they get to the case file. So let me give you an example of the timing relating to these civil party applications. If you look at the first civil party application, location in our annex. That's number two in the chart. A document that's now been assigned the number E319 25.3.2, in our annex you will see the date of June 1, 2013. That is the date the application was signed by the civil party. The document was processed by the victim's unit on the 27th of June 2014. So about 1 year later. And when you look at these documents, the stamp that you will see on the cover page with the date is not the date it was put on the case file, it's the date it was processed by the victim's unit. So this application signed June 2013, processed by victim's unit June 2014. The application, the original Khmer, was notified and placed on the case file on the 1st of September 2014, and the English translation of that application was placed on the case file on the 11th of March 2015. Another thing I want to bring to the court's attention is that some of the dates listed in our annex, which is a printout from our case map database, turn out to be incorrect. I checked into this because when I looked at the annex on Friday, there was a number of applications that had 2009-2011 dates, and that seemed early for me. And when I checked the actual dates of these, there are 17 applications that we listed as, or that were listed from the case map printouts as 2009 or 2011, which were all actually dated or signed by the civil party in 2013. There is only two of these applications that were earlier. And again, to give you a sense of the timing related to these applications, let me point out one of those. Number 33 on our annex is one of the two civil party applications that was from 2011. It was assigned by the civil party applicant on the 14th of June 2011, filed by his lawyer on the 30th of June 2011, processed by the victim's unit on the 13th of November 2012, and not placed on the case file and notified to the parties, including us, until the 8th of May 2013. The English translation of that application was posted 30 April 2015. So, in terms of your question regarding timing, it should be understood that the dates in our annex, in addition to some of them being incorrect, do not represent the dates these materials became available to our office. All that said, we all understand it is far from ideal for us to have to file these the week before trial setting is to begin. That is certainly something we don't want to do, would like to try to avoid. Everyone in this court works with limited resources, including the people who have to process and file these civil party applications, which I presume is why they take a while to work their way from the civil party into the case file. So, while it is, if you look at the actual dates, the English translations of these applications generally became available to us between 2014 and 2015. Nonetheless, our office has to set priorities in terms of what we do. So our first priority with the case for investigation and disclosure issues was the interviews, the witness interviews conducted by OCIJ. Those struck us from the beginning as something that was an important source of evidence. And our first effort was to get on top of those and make sure the witness interviews were disclosed where relevant. The civil party applications were a second, the next priority of our office. And that is part of the reason that this timing comes now rather than earlier in this year. I wish we were able to have the resources and the ability to review all these civil party applications as soon as they come in. That's simply not the case. If we had allocated resources to review the some 1,000 civil party applications in case 4, we would have had to take away resources from other things. So I think that, I hope that answers your first question in terms of the substance and timing of what we disclosed. Let me address your other question, which is, does this affect the ability to go forward? I believe the answer to that is no. Reason? There are almost 100 OCIJ witness interviews relevant to trapping Thama that have been before the parties for some time. Those from case 2, which have been available since the judicial investigation, and those from case 4, which were made available in March or April of this year. There are another 84 witness statements, primarily DC CAM interviews, some originating in case 2, and others that were part of a later group of DC CAM interviews that were included in our June 2014 trial document list. And there were 99 civil parties who filed applications or supplementary statements relating to trapping Thama Dam in case 2. Why am I telling you all this? There is a wealth of information that has been available to the parties for a long time, and because of that, it is highly unlikely that there is any unknown or new information in these largely civil party applications that would have any effect on how our office or the other parties will proceed in questioning the witnesses who are to be heard in trapping Thama. It's inconceivable to me, with there being almost 200 witness interviews and 100 civil party applications relating to this trapping Thama Dam, that these new case civil party applications from case 4 cover any new ground. I've looked over them myself, and indeed, I would describe them as what you would expect. They're corroborative of what the other hundreds of victims who have statements already before this court have said about the general conditions at this dam. Is this something that would affect how we would proceed this week? No. The only document I would point out that I believe is likely to be used over the next few weeks is a civil party application that comes from 2 TCW 908. This document is number 48 on our annex. And this is an individual who is scheduled to testify. He is the last trapping Thama Dam witness, however, number 11 on the list. So I'm assuming or estimating that he won't testify for probably 3 weeks. So that, I hope, answers your questions. I'm prepared to answer any other questions you may have.
Merci, Merci, Monsieur le Président, de me donner la parole. Merci, Monsieur le Procureur, pour ces explications. J'ai personnellement une question. J'ai lu donc l'annexe qui est jointe donc, à votre requête. Je note que pour un certain nombre de documents, vous n'avez pas fait mention de leur numéro ERN, ni en Khmer, ni en anglais, ni en français. Est-ce que vous pourriez nous donner quelques précisions concernant les versions de ces documents et celles qui sont disponibles en Khmer, en anglais ou en français? Je suppose que tous ces documents sont disponibles en Khmer, et je vous donne bien d'être sûr. Et est-ce que vous pourriez nous dire combien sont disponibles en anglais et s'ils sont également tous disponibles en anglais et combien sont disponibles en français? Puisque tout à l'heure, vous nous avez dit que sur les cautions de partie civile, il y avait à peu près 94 pages d'informations qui étaient pertinentes. Je suppose que ce sont 94 pages d'informations en anglais. Voilà, donc c'est ma première question.
Thank you, Judge Laverne. I'm not sure which documents you're referring to that lack ERNs. The version of the annex that I'm looking at has ERNs. Perhaps there's been some error. There are a small number that there's maybe one of them or two that are only in Khmer. And there is one that is listed only in, is available only in English. But the others, I believe, all have Khmer and English ERN. But I need to go through and I'm flipping through it right now, and at least in the version that I have, almost all of them have both Khmer and English ERN. A smaller number have French translations. My observation is that with both the witness interviews and the civil party applications in case 4, they're being translated into English first, French after that. So I don't know whether there's a specific document that you're concerned of, whether there's something wrong with the annex that made it through into the filing. But the annex that I have does have those ERNs.
Alors, le document auquel je faisais référence, c'est un document E319/25.3. Je note que le document 4, le document 6, le document 8, le document 9, le document 11, 14, c'est un nombre quand même relativement important de documents, 17, 18, 19, 22, 28, 29, 36, un nombre significatif de documents ne mentionne aucun numéro d'ERN. C'est pour ça que j'avais quelques interrogations. Je vois par exemple 40, 42, 43, 45, 46, 49, 52. Donc un nombre relativement significatif ne donne pas d'indication de numéro d'ERN, ce qui m'amener à me poser des questions sur la disponibilité de ces documents dans les différents plans.
They are available, Your Honor. I'll need to take a look at what's happened. I can assure you that there is an annex that was prepared and I believe was our original annex filed that has ERNs for all of those. I have no idea why you have a version of an annex that doesn't have those ERNs. We will look into that and we will make sure that there is a version. We'll make sure there's a version circulated that has the ERNs. I don't know why that is, because the copy that I'm holding has ERNs for every document, with the exception of two that are only in Khmer and one that's only in English. But I will look into that and make sure that they're there. But I can assure you that In terms of what will be placed into the folders, electronic folders, there are Khmer and English translations for all these documents, except for three, which are only one language. Electronic
ដើម្បី បញ្ជាក់ ច្បាស់ ថា វា មាន ទាំង លេខ EON ខ្មែរ និង លេខ EON អង់គ្លេស.
Je vous remercie pour ces précisions. Je n'aurai pas d'autres questions à poser.
សូមអរគុណ លោក សាប្រិយា ដែល បាន ឆ្លើយ បញ្ជាក់ ខ្ញុំ អស់ សំណួរ ហើយ លោក ប្រធាន.
អរគុណដែលបន្តទៅនេះឲ្យមានផ្ដល់វិធីការជូនទៅក្រុមសហមិត្តវិនៅមុខតំណាងដើមរឹងរដ្ឋបវិនីដើម្បីមានឱកាសក្នុងការធ្វើសារណាពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងបញ្ហានេះ.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Bonjour à tous. Est-il possible que nous formulions nos observations après avoir entendu les observations de la Défense pour que nous puissions éventuellement réagir à d'éventuelles requêtes ou demandes concrètes de la part de nos confrères? Sinon, je peux bien évidemment me contenter d'observations générales et vous demander, Monsieur le Président, d'avoir éventuellement la parole en réponse à la Défense, et comme vous le souhaitez. Très bien, je vous remercie. Nous avons de très très courtes observations pour rappeler tout d'abord que nous sommes, Hank Pik et moi-même, les co-avocats principaux, dans la même situation que les avocats de la Défense. Nous n'avons pas accès aux dossiers 3 et 4, et donc nous avons découvert ces documents vendredi, comme les autres parties, dans le folder qui nous a été mis à disposition. Nous voyons qu'il y a 54 documents en Khmer, 54 documents en anglais. Donc nous sommes partis du principe que l'ensemble des documents étaient traduits en anglais et que seulement 20 documents étaient traduits en français. Nous avons pris connaissance de ces documents vendredi après-midi. Nous nous en rapportons à la sagesse du tribunal quant à savoir si un report de l'audition de certains témoins de Trapéantma est nécessaire ou non. Nous avons toujours été, je pense, mesurés dans nos observations au sujet de la question de la divulgation. Nous comprenons d'un côté parfaitement les éventuelles objections et requêtes de la Défense, car chaque partie doit être en mesure de décider par elle-même et pour elle-même les documents et les informations qui nous paraissent importantes pour la conduite de ce nouveau segment. Et d'autre part, nous avons aussi coutume de rappeler ce qui est important pour nous, à savoir que le procès aille de l'avant de la manière la plus rapide possible. Nous faisons donc confiance à la Chambre pour faire la balance de ces différents droits des parties au procès. Nous partons du principe que cette semaine peut aller de l'avant dans la mesure où nous avons un témoin sur Tampon Chnang Airport et un témoin sur le barrage du 1er janvier. Mais encore une fois, nous nous en rapportons à la sagesse du tribunal sur ce point et comprenant les éventuelles objections des autres parties.
អរគុណជាបន្តទៅនេះអំពីផ្ដល់វិធីការជូនទៅក្រុមមេធាវីការពារក្តីជាដំបូងគឺក្រុមមេធាវីការពារក្តីលោកនុនជាដើម្បីមានឱកាសធ្វើសារណាតបទៅនឹងការលើកឡើងដាក់បង្ហាញឯកសារថ្មីរបស់សហមេធាវីសហប្រារិយាញាសូមអញ្ជើញលោកមេធាវី.
Thank you, Mr. President. Good morning, Your Honours. Good morning, Council. I think it might be worthwhile to put this last disclosure in a little bit of perspective. We have done some
some math and
have now seen that this is the 13th
disclosure since the first one in November 2014. Those 13 disclosures bring us to a total of 7,744 pages plus an estimate 600 pages, a total of 8,344 pages, so almost 8,500 pages. To remind the chamber of earlier disclosure, I would like to refer to, for instance, the disclosure of 20 March 2015, where we received about 2,600 pages. Disclosure number 10, April 28, 2015, where we received about 1,057 pages. Now, with another 600 pages, like I said, bring it to a total of 8,500 pages. Speaking about resources, have we been able, as the defense been able, to read all these new documents coming from case 3 and 4? The only answer that we can give to that question is marginally. We have had a very demanding trial schedule in the last months before the recess. Of course, we had to prepare for the three hearings in appeal held by the Supreme Court Chamber early July. Have we really been able to properly read these documents in the sense of really evaluating the documents as evidence? No. The answer to the question is no. Have we been able to discuss the content of these disclosures with our client? No. Now again, a day before we start a new segment, we are again being confronted with 600 new pages. So it's simply for us impossible to even pretend to having read these documents. I have no idea how the judges of the trial chamber are doing this. We certainly can't, especially taking into consideration our resources in relation to the prosecution. That's my first point. My second point is I'm still a little bit puzzled as to the timing. I've heard, I've listened carefully to the international co-prosecutor on the timing of the filing of these civil party applications. Even if the date that I'm looking at, for instance, number three civil party application, the document D5857, if it's not from 2009, but let's say from 2013, why did it take 2 years to present this civil party application of this civil party? Why do we have to wait until now?
I don't understand
the delay in time of another 2 years. There are a number of other documents that are not civil party applications, in respect of which the timing also doesn't really make sense to us. For instance, the first document is an OCP interview of somebody whose name I shall not mention, but that's dated the 5th of August 2008. Why was that filed 7 years later? I don't understand. There's also a report of an execution of rogatory letter dated September 2011, and that's being filed now. Also, that is something that I don't understand. Actually, the same goes also for the written
records of investigation of the witnesses in case 4. I've looked through them, but most of the one is just from March 2015, one is from April 2015, one is from May 2015, one is from 10 June 2015, one is from April 2015. We are all fully aware that this segment was even scheduled to start before the recess. I really don't see a reason why I would say that the categorization of far from ideal is maybe the understatement of the year, I wouldn't say, but it's quite an understatement. What it all boils down to is that we simply have no room, we have no possibility to properly question the witness or the civil party that is upcoming. Obviously, we need to have a look, even only a marginal look, at these new civil party applications, whether they have any bearing or effect on these upcoming witnesses. But of course, maybe the most principled question is why should we even allow these civil party applications to enter our case? What is their material importance that would allow them to be brought into our case? Well, why can't we simply say that the lawyers and the judges in case 3 and 4 deal with these civil party applications? Why? What's the necessity, what's the strong necessity to have these civil party applications become part of case 2? Of course, I understand what's behind it. It's maybe speculation, but the idea that case 3 and 4 will ever happen, that's of course very unlikely. That's probably the reason why we are still being flooded with all that new evidence coming from case 3 and 4. But going back to the remarks I made in the beginning, putting this in perspective of almost 8,500 pages, I think we have now reached a moment that we should say enough is enough. Let these civil party applications belong to where they were originally filed in case 3 and 4. Let them deal with it. And if you think that should not be the situation, then obviously we need some time to have a look at them. We didn't receive them yet. We are in the lucky position, or lucky between brackets, that on Wednesday and Thursday we have two witnesses who are not related to this segment. So by postponing today's civil party and tomorrow's witness, we would in effect have a total week extra. But of course, I say that with the big caveat that actually having the resources and time to properly read these civil party applications, I don't think that is really the issue. Last remark, I might add that civil party applications are not just merely applications. In the judgment in 2-1, these applications have formed a very important part of the used evidence. Based on our experience in case 2-1, these civil party applications need to be considered, need to give the same weight as proper evidence coming from witnesses. And in addition, we have seen in 2-2, in this trial, that a lot of those civil party applications have all kinds of defects in them. Witnesses sometimes come here and say, "I've never said that." They are written down by unknown people who have sometimes no idea what the actual civil party has said. So we have to be very, very careful with these civil party applications. If we now let them in like this, they're in, they will never go out, and that is problematic. So I don't think we should make any distinction really between civil party applications as such and WRIs of proper witnesses. Mr. President, one, dismiss the request. Two, if you do not dismiss the request, give us at least today and tomorrow to have a first look at these new disclosures. Thank you.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Bonjour à vous, à la Chambre et à l'ensemble des partis. Je dois dire, Monsieur le Président, que du côté de la défense de Khmer Sophon, nous voyons ce problème de communication récurrent prendre des proportions alarmantes et qui pose un vrai problème en termes d'équité du procès. Je trouve particulièrement léger de la part de Monsieur le Co-procureur ce matin de nous indiquer que en une après-midi, en gros, il est possible de faire le tour de ces 54 nouveaux documents. Je pense que c'est à comprendre à la légère ce qu'est le travail de la défense, puisque quand on communique des documents, il ne s'agit pas simplement de faire de la lecture bête et méchante, mais il s'agit de faire un vrai travail de défense, à savoir de croiser les informations qui sont tenues avec d'autres éléments de preuve. Bref, il y a un travail d'analyse certain. Donc que Monsieur le Co-procureur reprenne un travail effectué par ses collègues en amont, il puisse passer rapidement sur les documents, c'est son choix et c'est sa possibilité, mais qu'on ne demande pas à la défense de bâcler ce travail. Ça, c'est un premier point. Le point le plus important, peut-être, est celui de ce glissement auquel nous assistons ces dernières semaines, ces derniers mois, devrais-je dire, sur l'introduction dans le cadre du procès 002 de tout un tas d'éléments qui viennent d'une instruction qui est en cours. Et quand je dis qu'une instruction est une instruction qui est en cours, j'insiste sur ce point parce que, comme mon confrère de l'équipe de Nontia vient de l'indiquer, il y a des équipes de défense dans le procès. Dans les instructions 003 et 004 en cours, avec des droits qui sont attachés aux personnes mises en examen ou en tout cas en cours d'enquête, ils auront la possibilité, s'ils le veulent, de faire des demandes d'actes, ce qui n'est pas notre cas ici aujourd'hui. Donc on nous demande l'introduction de plus en plus fréquente, mon confrère a rappelé les chiffres tout à l'heure, de documents pour lesquels nous n'avons aucune prise. Aujourd'hui, la question est de savoir quel est le but de la communication par les coprocureurs. S'agit-il de documents qui sont susceptibles d'être à décharge, auquel cas ce serait intéressant que l'on puisse savoir lesquels et qu'on puisse savoir sur quel point. S'il s'agit simplement d'avoir de la preuve supplémentaire, est-ce que la preuve dans 002 n'est pas suffisante? Et de ce que j'entends, de ce qu'a indiqué M. le coprocureur ce matin, en gros, il nous dit « Ah oui, les documents, on peut les revoir rapidement parce que de toute façon, ils n'apportent rien d'extrêmement nouveau. S'ils n'apportent rien d'extrêmement nouveau, pourquoi est-ce qu'il faudrait les intégrer dans ce procès? Pourquoi avoir à nouveau des tonnes et des tonnes d'éléments de preuve sur lesquels, encore une fois, nous n'avons pas de prise. Je rappelle que nous ne sommes pas partis aux instructions dans 003 et 004. Donc, ma première réflexion serait de dire, si c'est si peu important que, comme Monsieur le Procureur l'a indiqué ce matin, mais dans ces cas-là, qu'on les accepte pas, qu'on les rejette, il n'y aura pas de problème de délai. Et ça, c'est le troisième point sur lequel je veux insister. Nous nous retrouvons ces derniers mois dans la position de devoir quémander
des délais supplémentaires pour examiner des documents qui sont susceptibles d'entraîner une condamnation pour nos clients. Nous retrouvons dans la position de devoir, dans des conditions difficiles, en même temps que nous avons d'autres tâches à mener dans le même temps, à devoir toujours nous plier, être toujours plus souples et travailler toujours dans des conditions les plus désagréables et les moins à même d'assurer la défense de nos clients, parce que ben oui, il faut que le procès avance. Ah non, je n'ai pas de problème pour que le procès avance, c'est l'intérêt de mon client, mais pas dans ma partie condition. Aujourd'hui, on vous dit 54 documents, ah ben non, c'est 500 pages, mais en fait, il n'y en a que 94 qui sont utiles. Dixit, monsieur le coprocureur, j'ai envie de dire, c'est peut-être la position de l'accusation. Moi, à l'instant T, je n'ai pas eu accès à ces documents. Nous devions signer, comme c'est le cas pour les documents venant de l'instruction, nous devons signer une décharge avant de pouvoir avoir accès à ces documents. Donc, à ce jour, nous n'avions pas prévu d'être vendredi au bureau. Nous sommes là aujourd'hui. Il n'y a qu'aujourd'hui que nous serons en mesure de signer cette décharge qui nous donnera accès à des documents. À des documents qui, pour... la plupart d'entre eux ne sont pas disponibles en français non plus. Donc là, il y a une question aussi de délai d'examen avec la nécessité de devoir croiser et travailler avec les personnes qui travaillent en Khmer et en anglais de l'équipe. Ça, c'est un autre point. Donc, aujourd'hui, on nous dit « Ah mais non, mais on peut quand même continuer sans problème. Il n'y a pas de problème. Ça ne sera pas la défense. Ne sera pas, en tout cas, empêchée de poursuivre la chambre pour poursuivre son travail comme si de rien n'était. Alors, à quoi servent ces 54 documents si on peut continuer comme si de rien n'était? Je le demande. S'ils servent à rien, ben on les exclut. Point après. S'ils servent à quelque chose, s'ils sont utiles et si les procureurs sont susceptibles de les utiliser, que ce soit maintenant ou plus tard, en demandant leur versement sur le fondement de 87.4, et ben, il faut que la défense ait le temps d'en prendre connaissance. C'est le béaba du principe équitable, c'est le béaba de l'égalité des armes entre les parties. Nous, aujourd'hui, nous sommes aveugles. Je vous parle de documents dont je n'ai vu que la description en annexe. Je ne sais pas laquelle est leur contenu. Je ne peux pas vous dire si, oui ou non, on peut poursuivre avec la partie civile. Donc, une solution très simple, encore une fois, c'est d'écarter ces documents et qu'on arrête de faire entrer dans le procès 02 l'instruction de 003 et 004 en cours. Elle n'est pas terminée, on ne sait pas ce qui peut se passer, on ne sait pas quelle demande d'acte pourrait avoir lieu pour demander à telle ou telle partie civile de venir préciser tel point. Et là encore, mon confrère Nonchia a indiqué, on l'a été encore il y a quelques semaines devant cette chambre, un certain nombre de parties civiles ont montré à quel point certains des documents qui ont été remplis en leur nom n'étaient pas fiables. Aujourd'hui, on voudrait qu'on puisse les intégrer comme ça, sans que ces parties civiles aient un jour à déposer devant cette chambre. Donc, de deux choses l'une, soit il y a des éléments fondamentaux pour lesquels l'accusation souhaite que ces documents soient entrés au procès, ou que ces témoignages soient entendus par la Chambre, ils font une demande. Et à ce moment-là, il y a un vrai travail de contradictoire. Je vois que je m'emballe, je parle un peu vite, je vais essayer de ralentir. Donc, soit il y a un vrai travail de contradictoire, il y a des personnes que l'accusation entend entendre faire déposer devant la Chambre, et ils font une demande en ce sens. Il faut qu'on arrête de faire rentrer un nombre infini de déclarations écrites et d'éléments écrits sur lesquels nous n'avons, encore une fois, qu'extrêmement peu de prise. Une chose est claire, si vous décidez que ces éléments doivent être communiqués finalement aux parties et doivent être et peuvent être utilisés par les parties, il est clair qu'il est impossible d'entendre un quelconque témoin ayant rapport avec le site de Trampingtma. Ça, c'est soit très clair, il ne s'agit pas de continuer et de nous laisser, nous, à l'aveugle, avec un handicap par rapport au procureur. Ensuite, une vraie question, je pense que sur laquelle il va falloir revenir, c'est la question, encore une fois, du poids qui devrait être accordé aux déclarations que vous avez déjà admises en preuve par le biais de ce procédé et à la suite les éventuelles requêtes qui seront faites par le procureur en ce sens. Mais encore une fois, je pense qu'il faut bien se rappeler que nous sommes dans un procès dans lequel il y a une instruction et dans lequel M. Kyusampan a eu des droits et qu'en ce moment, il y a une instruction qui est en cours et on ne peut pas prendre pour argent comptant les déclarations qui sont encore susceptibles d'investigation dans les procès 003 et 004. Donc, soit rejet total de ces nouveaux documents et nous pouvons continuer. Si vous souhaitez que l'on puisse se baser sur ces documents à un moment ou à un autre, il faut nous donner le temps de les examiner et ce n'est pas deux jours d'audience aujourd'hui qui seront suffisants. Donc, soit il y a un vrai report au moins d'une semaine en plus des deux jours de cette semaine, en cours, puisque nous n'avons pas de problème évidemment à continuer les témoins sur l'aéroport de Kampong Chnan et sur le barrage du 1er janvier, mais que l'on ne vienne pas nous dire que la communication est sans effet sur la préparation de la défense. C'est faux, ou en tout cas, c'est une perspective qui est uniquement de l'accusation.
Sống chơi, đâm đàng sạp đây nhá.
Thank you, Mr. President. They wouldn't sign acceptance. They didn't want them until lunchtime on Monday. As I said, I was not relying on anyone else's work. I went through these materials by myself Friday afternoon to see what was there. They refused to take the documents Friday at lunchtime. The Kyusampan team didn't respond, even respond to our email sent at Friday lunchtime offering to make these documents available. The second thing I want to make sure is clear, this is not a request for admission of these documents. This is a disclosure. It is a disclosure so that these civil party applications, which are in case 4, are available should the trial chamber, should the parties want to look at them. It's not our intention to request that these be admitted. The only ones I foresee potentially being admitted, for sure, are the ones that relate to, for example, the witness who's going to testify. I would think that probably one of the parties will want to make use of that document. But there is already, it is certainly true, there is already plenty of corroborative civil party applications, victim statements from people who won't testify as witnesses here without us having to admit these. So the reason we are disclosing them is just so they are available. Should one of the other parties look and say, oh, this particular individual looks quite interesting to me, I would like to request them to come and appear at some time in these proceedings, which will continue for another year. We want that option to be available. Now, should the defense not want us to disclose further civil party applications, we would be happy to be relieved from that burden. But it will need to be done with the clear waiver and statement from the defense. We, of course, would continue, instead of doing what we did here, which was to make available as a disclosure all the interviews we were, or all the civil party applications. We would still disclose ones, obviously, that related to people who would testify. If there was a civil party application that was exculpatory, we certainly would make it available. If there was something that was of particular significance, we would do that. What we have done here is a disclosure of the civil party applications relating Trap Dieng Thammamat Dam as a matter of fairness to make sure they are available, not as a request to admit these documents. And that's an important distinction. Couple other points. The OCP interview from 2008, this disclosure was done while some of us from the trial team were not here. The reason this was not disclosed earlier was because it really doesn't have any substantive information on Trap Dieng Thammamat. It's someone who said they knew of the site, but then said they didn't have any information about it. Our instructions to people were to err on the side of disclosure, but not to disclose documents where someone mentions Trap Dieng Thammamat Dam but doesn't provide any information. So the 2008 document is, as you will see when you look at the documents, not one that has any material information. It should not have been disclosed. I think I've responded to the issues that have come up, so unless you have any further questions.
Juste une précision que je souhaiterais voir apportée par le bureau des procureurs. Quel est ce document, quel est son numéro sur la liste des documents en annexe, le document de 2008 dont vous nous dites qu'il n'aurait pas dû être communiqué parce qu'en réalité, il n'est pas pertinent.
Oui, merci. Je vais vous donner un peu de temps.
Est-ce que c'est le premier, le D1.3.11.3?
Yes, the documents are in alphabetical order by the name, and so the name of this person, yes, this is the first one that appears. And it's not as if there's anything that's been improperly disclosed. It's simply when I read this interview on Friday, the witness says that they participated in the building of the Trap Dieng Thammamat Dam, but then when asked what were the conditions, said, I did not participate in the work. For me, if I were here when this disclosure was made, we wouldn't have disclosed this just because it does not seem to be of any weight. That's simply the point I'm making about this 2008 document. The reason it wasn't disclosed earlier was because we reviewed it and decided it wasn't of any particular relevance. And somehow in the process of doing this disclosure, it got thrown into the mix.
បាទអរគុណលោកពូរដ្ឋមន្ត្រីយោបល់ដែលបានលើកឡើងពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងបញ្ហានៃការស្នើសុំដាក់បង្ហាញឯកសារពីសំណុំរឿង 004 មកក្នុងសំណុំរឿង 002របស់សហភាពញាដែលបានធ្វើដំណើរដាក់មកអង្គជំរះកាលពីថ្ងៃទី 24 ខែកក្កដាកន្លងទៅនេះ
ហើយដើម្បីបានច្បាស់លាស់នេះគឺអង្គជំរះសូមប្រកាសសម្រាប់ដំណេះរហូតដល់ម៉ោង10:20នាទីសូមអញ្ជើញចូលវិញដើម្បីបន្តកិច្ចដំណើរការសម្រាប់ការម្យ៉ាងទៀតគឺរយៈពេលវែងក្នុងការសម្រាប់នេះដើម្បីអង្គជំរះពិភាក្សាសម្រាប់លើបញ្ហានេះជាមុនសិនមុននឹងដំណើរការសម្រាប់ការទៅមុខទៀតនៅក្នុងថ្ងៃនេះបាទសម្រាប់សិនចុះ
សូមអញ្ជើញក្រោកឈរ